Thanks. So, the motivation. Oh, that.
Okay, thanks.
Was a very short talk. So for the best. All right. Let's see if it'll work this time. And it's still working. So, okay. The motivation for this talk. It's this little example here. So imagine you have this little robot, and you want to get to the gold, and you have two options. You can solve this maze, and this is representing something that's computationally very costly, and you have this other action that it's straightforward, get it where you want to go, but with probability 0.25, you're going to die. The robot is going to explode. So one way of solving this problem is to perform heuristic search. If you're going to do heuristic search, you need a heuristic. So far, to compute a heuristic, what we do, we relax this problem by getting rid of the probabilities. And when you look at this deterministic problem, what you did is you split this action in two, so now the robot can go straight to the gold or can decide to die, literally. The nice thing about this is a deterministic problem, so you can use any technique from deterministic planning. The bad thing is once you bring this guidance back, it will tell you, oh, just go straight for the gold, and it's oblivious to the fact that you might die when you try to do that, right? So this is the motivation, and in this talk I'm going to show two different ways of solving this, meaning how to compute heuristics without doing this. The heuristics will be aware that you might die if you try to go straight to the goal. Then we're going to extend that and show that these heuristics can also take care of cost constraints. And I will finish with a new algorithm that the search and the heuristic computation happens at the same time. And that the nice thing is all of this is the first time that happens, and this algorithm is able to merge all of them once and compute all of these at the same time. So our setting is we have a probabilistic planning problem with goals, so we can think about MDP with goals. We are going to use a factored representation, so if you're aware of CESPLUS, it's going to be a probabilistic version of CESPLUS. And I'm going to present this using this runny example, that it's a little robot that want to move inside this grid, and it can move in any of these positions, and these are deterministic actions. There's no probabilities except in this slippery location. In this slippery location, the robot will try to move. With probability 0.9 will fail. It would stay there, probably 0.1 moves. So we encode this problem as follows. We are going to have two variables at x and at y to represent each one of the dimensions of the grid. Each one of these variables have different dimensions. For at x is 1, 2, and 3. And at j and at y, j and k. The initial state is just a valuation of these variables. The goal is another valuation. The actions are north, south, east, and west. And the way they're encoded is you're going to have your preconditions, and the probabilities will appear inside of the effects as a probability distribution of deterministic effects. So for instance, if the robot is in the slippery position, when I go east, with probability 0.1 at x will be updated to 3, so meaning it will go there. Probability 0.9, nothing will happen, the robot will stay where it is. Then we have the cost of actions, that is a function of just the action. And for this little example, I'm going to assume that's always 1, but it can be any arbitrary cost. So what we want to find is the optimal solution. That's the solution that minimizes the expected cost to reach the goal from the initial state. And just to give an example of why is the expected cost, so if we always apply east, the robot tries to go here and then there, the expected cost of that solution is 11. So it's one unit of cost to get here. Here will fail probably 0.9, succeed 0.1, so in expectation I'm going to execute that 10 times. So a heuristic for these problems is a lower bound on that optimal solution. Any function that gives you a lower bound is an admissible heuristic for that problem. And so far, the way it works is we are going to do a technique called determinization. So we are going to break this action that is probabilistic into two actions. One is good, so you're going to go where you want to go. The other one will always fail. And then you just go there and apply your favorite deterministic heuristic on that. But since we have this decomposition into variables, we could look at projection into those variables. What it means is we can project into the x coordinate or the y coordinate, right? So for instance, this position here now might be slippery, might be not. It's up to you for choosing because we collapse these two together. And here the same. So what it's nice about this, each one of these projections, they are probabilistic problems by themselves. So this is the representation of this little problem, this is little problem. It solves the issue of we didn't throw the probabilities away. But now, if we try to solve optimally each one of them, what we're going to get is the optimal solution here is you got your 2, got your 3, you got your the goal, great. The cost is 2, and here already in the goal, so cost 0. We didn't get any big improvement in capacity determinization, right? And the problem here is there's these 2 very, very distinct ways of using these variables. We can look at the cross product, and we're going to get the original problem. That was way too expensive to solve to start with. So we cannot compute a heuristic using that. And the other one is the independent, right? So if you look at this variables independently, that's what I just showed in the previous slide, we don't get a good bound. So the idea is, can we get something in between? Can we get something that's not independent, but it's not the full cross product? And that's our first heuristic. So the idea is, we are going to weakly tie these projections together. You can think about a weak synchronization of those 2 problems. And this synchronization will be the number of times an action is executed in these different projections should be the same, right? And here's what I mean by that. So again, is the 2 little problems, right? So if we try to do what I showed in the previous slide, solve them independently, you will get this solution, your expected cost will be 2 because of this. But now, using this constraint, this solution is infeasible because you're executing east 1, east 2 here, but in the other projection, you're not. So we rule out that solution. And if you look at the optimal solution using this constraint, now we have this green path. And what is interesting, if we focus in one single projection, look at that solution, there's some actions that do not make sense by themselves. For instance, there's no reason why you would apply North 1J there because you're not changing the state there. It makes sense when you look at the whole picture with that constraint. You're doing that to move this projection from J to K. So this weakly coupling, you're going to buy you a lot of extra information. For instance, the result, the bound, your heuristic will be 4, that actually it's the optimal solution for that problem. So we call this heuristic the projection occupation measure heuristic, or HPOM for short. We're going to encode this has an LP. You're going to use the dual representation. Each one of the projections are a little SSPs, so it's the straightforward dual representation for SSPs, meaning we have variables that represent the number of times an action is executed on expectation, each one of the states. The state now, it's a value for each one of the variables. The constraints are flow constraints, so we have this constraint saying that all the flow that gets into a state has to leave, excepting the initial state that's your source, in the goal state that's your sink. And then the objective is just to minimize the cross product of the number of times you execute each action in expectation and their cost. And then we add the time constraints. They're just saying that in the projections, these things have to, the number of times that actions are executed in expectation should be the same, right? So now the question is, I just show you one way of getting these heuristics considering probabilities. So is determinization dead? Right? Can everyone just throw all these papers away and forget about it? And the answer is no. So before, what I just showed you, we have 2 different projections, and we managed to kind of tie them together somehow. So we're going to do exactly the same thing. Remember, in determinization, we have these 2 things that work together. We split them apart, and now we're going to regroup them together. And we're going to do this by having this constraint that's telling you the number of times that, in this example, is good's going to happen divided by is bad, respect the ratio of their probabilities. So once you take these constraints, you can add to any deterministic planning heuristic based on LPs. You can feed their constraints on those heuristics, and those heuristics will be aware of probabilities now. So that counts in the end will represent an expectation. And that's exactly what we did. So we used the operator count from Florian, and this heuristic we call it the regrouped operator count heuristic. And what we do, we're going to have the operator count LP over the determinization. So our variables will be the number of times every effect is executed, because again, it's over the determinization. So we have the constraints that not really relevant right now. They are just linear constraints saying if you need to produce something because you need to the goal, you have to make sure you're going to do it. If you lose it, you have to redo it. And then you have your objective function, very, very similar to the other heuristic, and then the regrouping constraint, right? That's just a reordering of the constraints that I just showed. All right, so very quickly, here's some experiments. So the results are coverage, how many times out of 30 times these you manage to get to the optimal solution. So we have a cutoff time of 30 minutes, and the best coverage would be in bold. And if there's a tie in the best coverage, the one that solves the fastest would be in bold. So there's more experiments in the paper. Here I'm just showing two. And what is interesting is HROC, the second heuristic that I presented, it's always better than HBOM, and it's always better than all the others. Right? Now, the question is, why that happened? And the answer is not very complicated. Is HROC solves a much smaller LP, an LP that has less variables, less constraints. What means that most of the time will be an easier LP to solve. And in the paper, we show that HPOM was less or equal than HROC, but now we have a proof that they are computing exactly the same thing. So you have one that is a smaller LP and computes, it has informative, has the other one. That's why it's faster. But in the bigger LP of HPOM happens because we are representing and we have a copy of the action for each one of the projections. So it's a redundancy, right? But we can exploit that, and that's what I'm going to do in the second part of the talk. So now, we're going to add more things to your problem. You're going to add cost constraints to the problem. What means is we're going to have extra cost functions, and we're going to upper bound the expectation over that cost functions. So here's an example to illustrate. The same problem, the little robot moving the grid, but now every action has a throttle. So you can move faster or slower. So we have actually three positions, move slow, move normal, move fast. And then we have a time function and a fuel function. So move slow, 10 units of time, 1 unit of fuel, and it is fast the other way around. Now we have constraints over the time and the fuel. So you want to get from here to there with an expected time less than or equal to 4, expected fuel less than or equal to 4, too. So if we solve this problem using heuristic search, the way we would do it, we would have to give up from the probabilities, but we addressed this in the first part of the talk. But now, because of the other cost functions, we would have to look at each one of them individually. So what that means is, I'm going to ask, give me a lower bound for time, will be 1. Give me a lower bound for fuel, will be 1. If you look at the actions that they are recommending, they're saying, well, if you look at time, go fast. You're going to save time. You want to look at fuel, go slow. You're going to save fuel. They're the opposite actions, and none of them are actually feasible there. They violate, each one violates the other constraint. The only feasible action would be east normal. So the heuristic is not actually helping you too much. And what we did is, since both HPOM, HROC, they're based on LPs, they're counting actions, the expected number of times these actions are being executed, we can write these constraints to represent the expected costs on each one of the extra cost functions and upper bound them. So now if you add this to each one of their heuristics, then we get the first heuristics that are admissible for constrained SSPs, take probability into consideration, and take the cost constraint consideration. So far, I haven't exploited yet this redundancy in HPOM, and that is the third part, that's the very interesting part of this talk, in my opinion. So let's here introduce iDUAL, that is this algorithm to solve constrained SSPs using heuristic search. And the way it works, it's very similar to a star, where you have this initial state, this cloud represents the states you have explored so far, and then in this fringe, the different shades of green represent your heuristic, how close you think you are to the goal, and then what we do, we add these links from the fringes to the sink, and they pay this heuristic cost that you query a heuristic. Right, so this is represented as a flow problem. So you're going to pump 1 unit of flow here. We are going to encode this as an LP. The LP will find the optimal flow inside, taking into consideration the cost of the heuristics, and get that 1 unit of flow in the sink. Right? So far, what you would do, you would create these heuristics, get the number, write down the LP, send to your LP solver. But if you remember, HPOM, it was a flow problem too. And it's encoded in the same way that the whole problem. So what we can do, we can combine that. We can take this flow problem in HPOM and put in the same LP. So what we are doing now is we are pumping 1 unit of flow that we have to figure out how to route them inside of the states we have seen so far. From the fringe, we have to reroute them into the different projections and then get out of the sink. What it's nice about this approach is that now we don't have to query the heuristic to write down the LP, right? So this is happening at the same time. So Has the OP solver decided to route the flow in a particular way here, then a different flow will get to the projection. In this projection, we might see that one constraint is violated that might trigger a change here, that might change change back in this projection. And all of this happening in one go, right? So we are not stopping, querying heuristic and going back. So because of this, we are saying that these guys are working in unison. They're collaborating. It's not that one is driving each other. And we call this algorithm I2Dual. So if we look at experiments, there's just one other algorithm, our algorithm from last year, I2Dual, for heuristic search, and our new algorithm, I2Dual. And here's a very distinct number of heuristics. So here's the deterministic heuristics, uses determinization. Then we have the heuristics from the first part of the talk that are only aware of probabilities but not costs. And then we have the heuristics that are aware of probabilities and costs but not integrated. And then we have the integrated algorithm. And it dominates all the other combos, right? So to conclude, what I presented was HPOM, HROC, the first two admissible heuristics for probabilistic planning that are aware of probabilities. And each one of them comes from a different side of the community. One is looking at operator accounting, the other one is looking at projections. Then we extended that and added cost constraints and had the first heuristics again that takes probability in consideration because we inherit plus the cost constraints. And I show I2Dual, that is this new algorithm that it combines both the search part inside of the state you have seen so far in the heuristic computation all at once. That's it. Thanks.
Questions? I want to begin. Could you perhaps give me the intuition why HROC is equal to HPOM? You said that.
Unfortunately, there's no intuition. It's just a lot of algebra. At least I don't have an intuition yet. It's just a 2.5 pages on algebra in a compilation. Okay. So,
in the deterministic planning, looking at the projections in an LP and doing the operator counting turns out to be the same thing. Do you have any kind of formal relationships here as well? Is there like anything similar?
So isn't it that exactly that theorem that HPOM and HROC, they compute the same thing?
Yeah.
So that's a relation that we have. I don't have the intuition why. If you do have the intuition why, probably would expand from the deterministic one to the probabilistic. But I hope, because we have the extra constraints, right? So I guess it would go. Does this answer your question? I guess I didn't quite understand. Okay. Sorry, it was a fast talk. I apologize.
Yeah.
Sorry, I just was wondering whether you tested any of these on problems with dead ends, even in a finite penalty setting, if not?
Yes.
How is the performance?
And I do have a backup slide here for that. It performs pretty well. It's not the best always, but it's almost always. There's just one small trick. We have to add the same things that HMAX and LMCuts do in terms of seeing if there is if all the preconditions that you can tie together, the goal is still reachable. These two guys, they do not see the sequence of action. So sometimes it's clear for HMAX that there is that state's at that end, but they do not see it. So pretty much what we did, we would just query HMAX and say, is this at that end or not? If you say it's not, we would ignore their value and then compute our heuristic. And it's still, we would outperform. So it's even faster. Still querying them just because the guidance is so much better, right? So for instance, here, we are computing this guy and our guy, and it's still we solve faster because of the better guidance. Thanks.
Just an observation. You talk about the projection, no? I was thinking why you are so efficient. Maybe because you decompose the problems are problems and you take into account some independency in your formulation. So you are able to solve some problem independently in some way, so just the intuition. I was trying to get why you are so efficient.
So the efficiency, it's because of the space, right? If you would do the cross product, we'll get something exponential. Now we're just summing the space of them, right? That's why it's so much faster. And if you solve them independently, you don't have a good bound because things will not add up on each side. So once you add some accounting, then you can force things that should not happen in just one, but the other side forces, right? So imagine that it's two people trying to go to the same place and to try to negotiate more or less their preferences. That's more or less what this projection or this constraint is doing, making sure that both projections are happy with the solution.
I have another question, if I may. So your heuristics are formulated as LPs, which is very fine because constraint SSPs anyway can be solved with LPs formulation. But now if you think about regular SSPs, and if you forget the admissibility property, would it be possible to have some relaxed version of these heuristics that don't use LPs and that would be, I don't know, computed faster?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. And the problem here is if so far these heuristics, they are very obsessed about the optimality. And if you give up from the optimality, you might be able to, we don't know how to, for instance, add constraints that say, well, don't care about the optimality. But I think it's possible to, for instance, try to generalize H-add or any other non-admissible heuristic from deterministic planning to deterministic setting. It's just you're not going to be able to use any one of these constraints. Mm-hmm. But I think that's a very interesting problem. And you know, it would be great to have a solution for that because it will make probabilistic planning a little bit more closer to the real world, because I guess not everyone cares about the optimal solution, you just care about a solution fast, right?
Yeah. Thanks. Another question? Okay, so let's answer the speaker again.